Then we'll discuss what are the concept of the slope over here. Now, what is slope? If you remember your marginal analysis, what we discussed before, maybe few session or maybe the last session, the marginal change is always whatever the change in the dependent variable due to one unit change in the independent variable. So, slope is to measure the relationship between the marginal change in the two related variable, and it can be also defined as the rate of change in the dependent variable as a result of change in the independent variable. So, through marginal analysis we know whether the dependent or the independent variable, how it changes when there is a change in the one variable. When there is a change in the independent variable, how it leads to change in the dependent variable, that we know through the marginal analysis. But slope, through that we can measure what is the exact nature of the relationship, whether they are positively related, whether they are negatively related, and we can also quantify the change, that what is the percentage change or what is the amount of change that has taken place in the dependent variable due to change in the independent variable. So, geometrically if you look at what is a slope, it representing the relationship between two variables in a line in case of a linear relationship, and or a curve in case of a non-linear relationship. So, the slope of the line or the curve shows how strongly or weakly two variables are related. So, in order to find out the slope, we represent graphically the relationship between two variables. So, if the two variables are linear variables, linearly related, we get a line. If the two variables they are non-linearly related, we get a curve. And slope generally says that how strongly or how weakly these two variables are related to each other. The steeper is the curve or the steeper is the line, the weaker is the relationship. Implication for this is that they are not strongly related or they are not related if there is a steeper line or steeper curve. It means there is no change in the significant change in the dependent variable, even if there is a change in the independent variable. However, if the curve or the line is more flatter or it has become more flat, it signifies that there is a stronger relationship between these two variables. Or we can say if there is a small change in the independent variable, it leads to a greater change in the dependent variable. So, when two variables they are represented through a line or a curve, the slope measures the change between these two variables, what is the amount of change, what is the nature of change, or in the other word we can say they can quantify whatever the relationship between these two variables. So, if they are steeper, they are not much related, if they are flatter, then they are related to each other. Now, taking the typical example of a demand function over here or demand curve over here, the slope is the ratio in the change in the dependent variable and change in the independent variable. So, if you look at it, in case of a linear demand curve, we always get a straight line demand curve. In case of a non-linear demand curve, we get a curve. So, with respect to demand curve, what is the slope? Slope is the ratio of change in the dependent variable D to the change in the independent variable. So, movement down the demand curve, it gives the decrease in the price. And if it is up the demand curve, it is the increase in the demand, and the ratio of the change in the price and the change in the demand gives the slope of the demand curve. So, if you know, demand function is a function of price. So, price is independent over here and demand is dependent over here. So, how to measure the slope over here? The change in the demand due to change in the price, that becomes the slope of the demand curve, because this slope measures the change in the demand curve due to change in the price. So, in this specific case, the slope is the change in the demand due to change in the price. Okay. So, we will see how the slope, generally we get slope in case of a linear demand curve and in case of a non-linear demand curve. Okay. Suppose we take the example of a linear demand function, that is dx is equal to 20 minus 2p x. This is a demand function. Okay. Now, when you find out the demand curve, or how to find out the demand curve from this demand function. Okay. So, let us say this is 2, this is 4, this is 6, this is 8, this is 10, 12, 14, 16, 18 and 20. And similarly, here we can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10. Okay. So, when the price is 6, suppose we say the quantity demanded is 8. Okay. When the price is 5, the quantity demanded is 10. When the price is 3, the quantity demanded is 14. Okay. So, price is 6. Quantity demanded is 8, we get 1 point of the demand curve. Then price is 5, quantity demanded is 10, we get the second point of the demand curve. Price is 3, quantity demanded is 14, we get the third point of the demand curve. If you join this 3 point, we get the demand curve. Okay. So, maybe this is point J, this is point K and this. Now, what is the demand curve showing over here? If it is demand for X, suppose, what is the demand curve showing over here? This is the change in the price of X and the consequent change in the quantity demanded of X. Price we are considering here, quantity we are considering here. So, if you look at y axis is P and Q is represented in x axis. So, this demand curve is essentially showing the relationship between the change in the quantity demanded due to change in the price. So, suppose the initial price, as we mentioned, initial price Px is equal to 6. Okay. So, the quantity demanded is 8 with respect to that. Now, suppose Px decreases from 6 to 5, quantity demanded increases from 8 to 10. So, this is what? This is the change in the Px and this is the increase in the Dx. So, this is minus because there is a decrease in the price. And this is positive or this is plus because there is an increase in the quantity demanded. So, when price of X decreases from 6 to 5, quantity demanded increases from 8 to 10. So, what is the value of del Px? Del Px is equal to minus 1 because it is changing from 6 to 5, or we can say maybe it is from 5 to 6, then it becomes 1. Then del dx is from 10 to 8 because this is the change in the x. So, del dx is 2. Okay. So, px is the independent variable and dx is the dependent variable. Due to change in the px, there is a change in the dx. So, given the value of del px is equal to 1 and del dx is equal to 2, what is the slope of a straight line demand function? The slope of a straight line demand function is the ratio of del Px by del Dx. So, this is the slope of the demand function. So, del Px and del Dx, this is become the ratio, and through this ratio we can find out the slope of a straight line demand curve between the point J and K. So, if you see the previous graph, this is the point J and K. So, through this ratio, we can find out the slope between the two two point J and K, and this becomes 1 by 2, which is equal to 0.5. Okay. So, given the demand function dx is equal to 20 by 2 px and px is equal to 6 and dx is equal to 8 initially, there is a change in the px from 6 to 5 and change in the quantity demanded from 8 to 10 that leads to the change in the price of x, that is del px, and change in the quantity demanded of dx, so which is 1 by 2 and the slope is 0.5. The slope, if you look at, since this is a case of a linear demand curve, the slope is constant throughout the demand curve. Okay. Now, suppose we consider that a price of x decreases from 5 to 3. Okay. This is again the change in the price of x. The quantity demanded changes from 10 to 14. So, this is 10, this is 14. This is the amount of change in the quantity demanded of x. Okay. So, if price decreases from 5 to 3 and quantity demanded increases from 10 to 14, we will find out what is del px over here and what is del dx over here. So, del px is 3 minus 5, that is minus 2, and del dx is 14 minus 10, that is 4. So, in this case, when you identify what is the slope between these two points, then this is again the ratio of del px by del dx, and which is again 2 by 4, and we are getting a value which is 0.5. So, in case of a linear demand curve, you get a constant slope throughout all the point of the demand curve, because the change in the dependent variable remain constant with respect to change in the independent variable. Next, we will see what is the, how we measure the slope of the nonlinear demand function. So, nonlinear demand function, let us take a functional form, that is dx is equal to 32 px minus 2, or we can say this is 32 by px square. Okay. Now, in case of a nonlinear demand curve, the slope of the curve can be measured between two points, between any two points, and then we can compare what is the slope between these two points. What is the essential difference between a linear demand curve and a nonlinear demand curve? In case of linear demand curve, the change in the dependent variable remains constant throughout the entire demand analysis or entire analysis period. But in case of a curvilinear and in case of a nonlinear demand curve, the dependent variable changes in a cyclic manner or in a different proportion at each point of the demand curve. That is the reason here it is necessary to measure the slope between two different points and again compare whether the slope is remain same or slope is decreasing or slope is increasing, or to identify what is the trend of the slope between different points of the demand curve. We take px on the vertical axis and dx on the horizontal axis. So, here we get 1, 3, or maybe we can get this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 6, 8, 10, 12, so on. And in case of px, we can say this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. When price is 5, the quantity demanded is somewhere between 1 and 2. So, let us say this is 1.3. When price is 4, the quantity demanded is 2, okay. And when price is 3, the quantity demanded is 3, and or maybe say it is somehow 3 point, if it is 3 then this is 3.5, and when price is 2 then the quantity demanded is 8. Basically, if you join this point, suppose this is point A, this is point B, this is point C, and this is point D. If you join all these 4 points rather, we get a nonlinear demand curve. Now, how will identify or how will measure the slope between 2 points? Now, what is the slope between point A and point B? Now, what is del Px over here? Del Px is the difference between 4 and 5, that is the change in the price, that is 4 and 5. So, from point A to point B, now what is the slope? That is del Px by del Dx. Okay. What is del Px? Difference between 4 and 5, so that comes to minus 1. And what is the difference in the quantity demanded? That is the difference between 2 and 1.3, so that comes to 0.7. Now, what is the slope over here? The slope over here is minus 1.43, okay. That is between point A and point B, the slope is 1.43. Now, what is the slope between point C and point D? So, between what is the change in del Px? The change del Px is between price 2 and price 3. So, this is minus 1. What is the change in the demand? The change in the demand is between 8 and 3.5. So, that leads to 4.5. So, this comes to 0.23. So, if you look at in a nonlinear demand curve, the value of the slope changes, or the value of slope is not constant in all point of the demand curve. So, when we measure or when we calculated the slope between point A and point B, we got a figure which is 1.43, and when we calculated the slope between point C and point D, the value of the slope is 0.3. So, we can say that the slope of the nonlinear demand curve is different between the different points. Now, when you measure the slope at a point of the curve, okay, what may be the limitation or what may be the constant over here? In case of a nonlinear demand curve, what we calculate the slope at two different points, taking the change in the price, taking the change in the quantity demanded, and we then measure the value of the slope. So, what are the limitation over here when you measure the slope at a point on a curve? This method may not be reliable, because particularly in this case, when the change in the independent variable is large, because slope is different from any set of 2 points within the chosen 2 points of the curve, and the method is not much of help in case of a optimum solution to the business problem that has to be found, because of an optimization problem may involve a polynomial function. So, measuring slope particularly for a linear and non-linear, it is possible, but when it comes to polynomial, it is basically difficult to use the same method to measure the slope, and that is the reason the difference between two variables also sometimes so large that it is difficult to do an analysis by measuring the slope in this way. That is the reason there is a technique of the differential calculation has come into existence. In order to understand the margin, in order to measure the marginal change in the dependent variable due to change in the independent variable, particularly when the change in the independent variable approaches 0, and the measure of such marginal change is generally known as the derivative. The derivative of a dependent variable y is the limit of change on y when the change in the independent variable x approaches 0. So, because of the limitation to measure slope at a point in a curve, the technique of differential calculus generally comes into picture. So differential calculus is generally used to find an optimum solution to the problem, and this is used in the derivative of a constant function, derivative of a power function, derivative of a function of the sum and difference of the function. Function is a product of two functions, derivative of a quotient, derivative of a function of function. So we'll check individually each function and how we use differential calculus over there. But before that, we'll see that how we can find out the differential calculus or how we can represent the differential calculus graphically. So we are considering y is the dependent over here and x is the independent over here. So when we represent this in a graph, we take a function, that is y is equal to function of x, okay. X1, x2, this is y1, this is y2. Now, what is the change in the x, that is change in the x from x1 to x2, this is the change in the y from y1 to y2. So this is point A and this is point B. Now when x increases from x1 to x2, y increases from y1 to y2, okay. So point A shifts from, so demand function shifts from point A to point B. So in here, what is del x now? Del x is x1, x2, and del y is y1, y2. How will I identify what is the slope of this function? So slope of this function is del y by del x, which is y1, y2 by x1, x2. So when the change in the dependent and independent variable is slow, it's very small, the slope can be calculated from the method of the differentiation or the method of the differential calculus. Now we'll take the same example. Here we have just taken a general function. Now we'll take a function specifically to the demand function to understand this differential, how differential calculus is being used in order to calculate the marginal change or in order to measure the changes between the two variables, that is dependent variable and the independent variable, okay. So let's take a demand function, that is dx is equal to 32 px to the power minus 2, okay. So this is a demand function. We'll use the differential calculus to find out the slope, and when this differential calculus is require or when this differential calculus is helpful, when the change in the independent and dependent variable is very small, it is difficult to find out the value of slope by the formula what we discussed earlier. So if you are taking the first order derivative equal to 0, then it is become del dx with respect to del px, and so this comes to minus 2, 32 px minus 3. So this comes to minus 64 by px cube, okay. So if we'll take the reciprocal of the above equation, then this is del px, del dx, and this is minus px cube by 64. So if you take this point in the point B, considering this function in point B, what we did the graphical representation earlier, and substituting price is equal to 4, okay. So taking this and substituting price is equal to 4, now what will be the value of this equation? That is minus 4 q by 64. So this is minus 64 by 64, which is give equal to the minus 1. So the slope of the demand curve using the differential calculus, both by the tangent method and by the differential calculation method, this is 1. So in this case, what we did, we took the demand function, the same demand function what we did earlier by taking the general tangent method to understand the slope, and we found the value of the slope is equal to minus 1. Now we have taken a different formula or maybe different methods, that is the rule of differentiation or the difference calculation or derivative to understand or find out the slope, and following the differential calculus, taking the first order derivative and putting the value of p, we got the value of slope which is equal to minus 1. So if you remember, in case of a tangent method also, the value of slope we got as the minus 1. So whether we follow the tangent method or whether we follow a differential calculus method, taking the same demand equation, the slope becomes equal. The only difference here is that we cannot use the tangent method with all changes in the dependent or independent variable. When the dependent and independent variable, the change related to them is small, in that case only the differentiation or the differential calculation method can be useful. So in the next session, we'll look at what are the rules of differentiation, and as we discuss that, how we deal with the derivative of a constant function, power function, function of sum and differences of equation, quotient, then power function, everything we'll discuss in the next class related to the rule of derivatives or the rule of differentiation.